sing glory, glory, glory to his name forever. Glory, glory, glory to his name.
We give you praise this morning, Lord God. The name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Please remain standing while we look to the Lord in prayer this morning. Caught you all off guard, didn't I? Praise the Lord. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Praise God. This morning, Pastor Dan and Sister Diane are in Newfane at the church that's pastored by Dan Alberta. And the name of the church is Living Waters Church. I was going to say, my mind goes blank at the time. It should have something in the blank. But I guess that happens to a few people. They say it comes with birthdays, but I'm not really convinced about that. I'm glad that you're here in the house of the Lord today. And if you're watching by Facebook or you're watching through other social media, we welcome you and we want you to join in with us. Let's pray this morning. Father, today we welcome your presence. We welcome you to be here because you are Lord of Lords and you are King of Kings. In the times in which we live, O Lord, the times in which we sense changing and winds of change, we stand with you, O Lord, because you are the unchanging one. Lord, your mercies are for everlasting to everlasting. Your grace is sufficient, and we thank you that your power is not limited in any way. You have not grown old, but you are the rock of all ages, and we thank you we can place our confidence and faith in you. Father, today, now fill this, your house, and fill our hearts, your people, with your presence, O Lord. Speak to us today. Lead us, O Lord, today. Have something for each and every one of us today, and may we remember your house today and your presence and your love. In the wonderful name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen. 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 Thank you. Now you may be seated. And we do want you to keep in mind your opportunities for this week. If you have a copy of the bulletin indicates that we're going to have our adult prayer, praise, and share meeting tonight at 6 p.m. And I'm going to let Jesse make an announcement. Come on, Jess.
Thank you, Pastor. Good morning. Okay, so the first time in a couple years, we have seniors in the youth group. We actually have six of them, even though only one attends here. Nate, you want to stand up for us? Yeah. Okay, so on June 17th, so we're giving you an entire week and a half notice, we're going to have a dinner to recognize these six seniors. We've got Nate, Alex Berry, Emma Roush, Faith Ann Vanderwalker, and why am I blanking? Karina and Jacob, thank you. Okay, so if you are a member of their family, then we're paying for your dinner. But if you are not an immediate member of the family, we're asking for $5. It's going to be a chicken dinner. Should be a lot of fun. Going to give them some swag and some high fives as they go out the door, graduate, move on, leave us behind, you know. But yeah, June 17th, that's a Thursday night, I believe, at 6:30. There's a sign up in the foyer. We're going to have it this week and next, and then the dinner's the following week. So I will stop rambling on. That is enough. Thank you very much.
All right. I'm glad you just witnessed. I'm not the only person with blanks, didn't you? Okay. All right. Praise God. By the way, a chicken dinner at $5, I paid $12 for a chicken dinner yesterday that I had that supported a sportsman's club. That's a bargain. And you'll be a blessing, too, to let all those seniors know that they are very important. Praise God. Praise God. So, Please do that. Your scripture verse today is one that's so appropriate. In your bulletin is the card, and I'd like to go over it with you this morning. And it's John 15:13. Would you say it with me this morning? John 15:13. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. Okay? That was kind of weak. Now, I know I see some gaps in the congregation this morning, but I think that you need to fill in the gaps with your voice today. So let's do that again, and let's quote the reference first of all, John 15:13. Let's do it again. Here we go. Great John 15:13. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. Amen. Amen. Today, as we celebrate the Lord's Supper, we celebrate the fact that he gave his life for us, and we honor him by partaking, symbolizing the relationship we have with him. This is a great verse of scripture just because of that and for that reason. And so let's say it again together in unison once again, starting with a reference, first of all. Okay, John 15:13. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. Praise the Lord. Greater love has no one. Praise God. I'm so thankful this morning. Praise God. We are here today to worship the Lord and to hear from the Lord. So I'm going to turn it back over to our worship team this morning. Let's praise God.
All right, let's stand and worship today. How about it?
I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. Tired of the devil's games, keeping me in bondage through my sorrows and chains. I can live better, I won't go another day. I am here to claim deliverance in Jesus' name. I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. Yeah. I have been loose, I've been set free. So pardon me a moment while I have a jubilee. For the joy of the Holy Ghost is all over me. I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord. Pardon me a moment while I have a jubilee.
praise this morning, Lord God. You're worthy to be praised, Jesus. We bless your name.
Everything for us. dark and sacred hill, where violence purchased peace. Innocent was bound to set the captives free. You have made a way, the lost are welcomed home again. give you praise today. You alone are worthy. We exalt your name, O Jesus.
Hallelujah.
We bless the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
He is the Lamb upon the throne. Hallelujah. We've come to that time in our service today when we want to remember the broken body and the shed blood of our Lord Jesus. Is there anyone who has need of a communion serving? You may be seated. Does anyone need a communion serving? Maybe ushers could deliver one to you. We need one at least over a couple on this side, please. Down front. Thank you, ushers, for being so gracious to be right on the ball with that today. Praise God. Praise God. Everybody, anyone still need to be served this morning? I know the children are with us today. And they're with their moms and dads, hopefully. And this is always a learning and a object lesson that we take the little wafer, which represents the body of Jesus. And when we eat it in remembrance of his body being broken. My scripture keeps turning off on me here, but it'll stay on for a moment. The scripture says that the Apostle Paul says, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you." And if you would take your element of his broken body in your hand, please. How that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." And that's exactly why we do that this morning. We do it in remembrance of the Lord Jesus Christ. And before we partake, let's pray. Father, today we hold in our hands the emblem of your broken body. We ask, O Lord, today that you would help us to partake in a way in which we connect with you, because you have connected with us. You connected with us with wood and slivers and spikes, O Lord, and the metal and the abuses that happened at Calvary's cross. You connected with us and took our place to take the penalty for our sin upon yourself. So, Lord, this morning as we partake together, we remember you. We love you, Lord. We thank you. You did something for us that no one else could ever do. And Lord Jesus, we thank you for your broken body. Your word also declares that by your stripes we are healed. And so, Father, this morning, as we partake of the emblem of your broken body, if there's anyone in the sound of my voice who needs a touch in their body today, we are believing you this day, Lord. By your stripes, we are healed. We saw the stripes. We know of the stripes. And today, Lord, we receive from you. Father, bless our partaking together in the mighty and precious name of Jesus. Amen. Shall we eat together? renewed all that partaking of communion with these prepackaged units is a little more difficult than having a simple open cup in your hand. But here we go. After the same manner also, Jesus took the cup when they had eaten supper, the scripture tells us, and he said, "This represents my blood shed for you. Drink ye all of it in remembrance of me." Let's pray one more time this morning over this. Father, today as we hold in our hands the emblem of the shed blood of your Son that you looked upon, Lord, most of us don't like to see the sight of blood. It gives us a squeamish feeling. But Father, you saw the blood of your Son poured out on a rugged cross about 2,000 years ago, just so the penalty might be paid once and for all for our failure to live the lives you called us to. Lord Jesus, as we partake of this emblem of your shed blood, this representative of your shed blood, this substitute for your shed blood, may we be reminded that the price was paid was beyond gold and silver and ransom. It was the blood of your precious Son. Father, bless our partaking. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we drink together? Hallelujah, hallelujah. We're going to worship the Lord some more. Praise God.
To save me, rain. morning, Lord God. You're the King of kings and the Lord of lords. You are Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. You reign forevermore, Lord God. We worship you today, Jesus. We bless your holy name.
You. You may be seated. Could we have our children come forward at this time? Are we going to children's church? All right. Got to be careful you don't get run over. Good morning, everybody. You all look so nice. And I can see somebody hiding behind somebody. Okay, very good. Some more. Anybody else? Last call. Okay. Praise the Lord. We are proud of you. Amen? Amen. We are proud of you and we are thankful for you. So we're going to pray right now. We're going to pray for our offering and we're going to pray that you have a great time in church today. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes, please? Lord Jesus, we love you today. And we are all children, just some of us have had more birthdays. And Lord, let the joy and the happiness and the excitement of your love thrill our hearts, O Lord, today as we prepare our hearts for the service that continues. We pray, O Lord, your blessing on the offering. We ask, O Lord, that you use it for your honor and glory. May it meet needs of many people, and we pray, O Lord, today that you will just use our church, use our children, use each of us, O Lord, to be a representative of you. We love you, praise you, and thank you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Oh, Lord, my God.
Thank you.
Lord God. You're worthy to be praised, Jesus. We bless your name, O God.
How great our Heavenly Father is. Hallelujah. Thank you, worship team. Thank you so much. The offering, by the way, of course, is a retiring offering. I didn't go into that little speech that I'm supposed to go back there, but you just heard it now, so there it is. Praise the Lord. This morning I have been reflecting on, as I prepared myself for these moments and these times, I've been reflecting on the call that the Lord put on my life when I was a teenager. When he called me into ministry, it was at a time in which my argument with God was, Lord, I can't do this. This is way beyond me. But he's promised to give us exactly what we need. And he's done exactly that. As a teenager, he called me. When I was just before I was 18 years old, I was filled with the Holy Spirit, had the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. And that was a very empowering experience. And it caused me to know that God's hand was on my life in a new way, in a very important way in my life. And so it's truly an honor to bring the word of the Lord to you today. Pastor Dan and Sister Diane are at Living Waters Fellowship. If you missed my first comments earlier today in Newfane, and that the pastor of that church is Pastor Dan Alberta. His parents have been longtime attenders of our church, and I've known both of the Albertas for a long, long time. I was a board member with Harry Alberta. Thank you for filling in the gaps, filling in the blanks. Harry and Rita, wonderful, wonderful people, praise the Lord. And if you want to kick my PowerPoint on the screen there it is. Whoops. Okay, I was looking forward and not looking backward at all. But my sermon today, I've titled it Simon Peter Points, okay? I want to talk about some things that happened in Peter's life, because there's been a parallel with what's happened in Peter's life. One of my subtitles is When Life Goes Zig and You Go Zag, or The Best and the Worst. Jesus called 12 very ordinary men. I was drawn to Simon Peter's experiences, and in this picture is one of the curious kind of ones. Of course, we don't have a real good picture of Simon Peter that was taken by somebody's cell phone, but this will tell you and it will remind you that Peter is actually withdrawing his tax payment from where it was stored. Did you get that? He's withdrawing his tax payment from where it was stored. When Jesus was asked, "Don't you pay taxes?" and Peter started stumbling around and trying to make answers for him, Jesus said to Peter, "Peter, go drop a line in the water, and the first fish that comes up, see what's in its mouth." There you have it, the tax. And so, how many of you have had your taxes paid by going fishing? Neither have I. My hand is not up as having that happen for me either. Okay, today Peter is a lot like I am, like you are, I suspect. He took a lot of pride in his personal skills as a fisherman, that the skills that were needed in his livelihood of fishing. I'm not a fisherman. I've never been much of a fisherman. I've fished a few times, but I haven't fished commercially like Peter did. And I'm sure that Peter always wanted to rank himself first in position when he was around Jesus. I have the feeling that when Jesus sat down somewhere, or when Jesus placed himself somewhere, that Peter probably was looking, how can I get close to Jesus? I want to get the seat next to him. I want to get a seat. If I can't get the seat next to him, I'm going to get the seat next to that one. I have the feeling that Peter was a competitive kind of a person, but he could be very compassionate for a cause. His passions could be really stirred up because he had not only temper, but he had passion. He had an ability to be excited about causes. And, you know, when people are excited about a cause, forget about common sense. Common sense oftentimes goes out the window when people are compassionate about a cause. But I can imagine that when Peter, and I'm going to read the scripture in a moment, when Peter said that Jesus was the Son of God, and Jesus commended him so, I can imagine that Peter almost glowed and purred like a cat. I can just hear him smiling to himself and thinking, this is great. I've got it right. I'm successful now. I've made my point. And here we are. And I'm in good standing with Jesus. I gave him the right answer for his question. But fear could be Peter's Achilles heel as well. When Peter became fearful, he was like you and I are. He had trouble really thinking straight and doing well. As a matter of fact, when Peter became really fearful at the trial of Jesus, as I said on my slide there, he threw Jesus right under the bus at that time. I'm going to give some of my very recent experiences on the road that Jesus and I have been traveling in recent days. You haven't seen myself at Oak Orchard for a couple of Sundays, I believe. And last Sunday, we were at the Mill City Assembly of God Church, the church where I was saved and where I grew up and where my first discipleship was. That's down in the town of Dalton, Pennsylvania. And I had lunch with the pastor following the service that day, and it was a time of attempting to reconnect with my past. They're no longer in the building where I worship. They've moved to a much nicer, a prettier, a larger building, more accommodating building than when I was worshiping God there, but it was a great experience. The reason that I was there is because I was visiting with my mother, who's been very sick of recently. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that as we go on today. Life is a journey, and I'm so thankful that life is a journey. It's not a parking lot, but it's a journey. If it was a parking lot, you'd be stuck right where you are. I don't like being stuck when I'm in an uncomfortable spot. I don't like it when it's too hot, or I don't like it when it's too cold, or I don't like it when it's too stressful. If it's enjoyable, that's a beautiful thing, but those things, sunsets don't last that long. The ice cream cones soon melt, and all of those kind of things that bring happiness and joy to me in a very physical way in life. But life is a journey of joys and of challenges. And there's great joy when a new baby comes into the family, usually anyhow. And the baby is welcomed, and the baby is a source of great joy. I got a chance this past week to get to see my great-grandson, my youngest great-grandson. He will turn 1 year old pretty soon. And I want to tell you something that kind of amazed me. He had a bottle of sweet tea, and he was eating baked beans. I don't know how that boy is going to turn out, but he's probably going to drink sweet tea and eat baked beans throughout his life. That's got to be real man food, right? Okay. He's quite a guy. There's joy in life when people get married. There are many happy things that are associated with weddings. There are many happy things that are associated with new jobs. Oftentimes, a new home is a very happy experience. A new automobile, new car, truck, or whatever it may be is a good experience. But we all have challenges in life, too. We all face times in life that are less than stellar. We faced challenges with sickness. We faced challenges with injury. We faced challenges over the choices that our children make. We face challenges with accidents. We face challenges today with layoffs and with closings and with all kinds of things, and with inflation moving on in life. And while we face those kind of challenges, the Lord doesn't leave us, but many times it seems like as we pray and ask God to change something about the circumstance, it just doesn't happen the way we would like to have it happen. Okay, I'm going to take you into my world for a few moments, and if I shed a few tears, just remember that I'm a big boy and I'll recover in time. Okay, praise the Lord. Back in the month of May, on the week of that, the Sunday was May the 16th. I was down visiting my mother, because my mother has taken sick and has actually been in the hospital about four times in the last month, and she's currently this morning in rehab. And she went, as a matter of fact, from rehab to the hospital by ambulance one time in the about a week ago, a little over a week ago now. But anyhow, I was down visiting my mother because my youngest sister is trying to be a caregiver for her and trying to work her job as a bank teller as well. And my mother she's had a lot of birthdays. She's had 96 birthdays, and of course, things are not what they once were. But your mother is your mother. Can I get an amen? Amen. How many mothers do you have? One. Unless you're adopted, and then you have two. Okay. And you've been adopted by Jesus, so you have a heavenly father, and you had an earthly father too. But anyhow, so I've been down visiting my mother. I went to stay with her to give my sister a little bit of relief from staying there overnight so she could go to work. And I went there. I was there over a Sunday. I was there over a Monday, and on Tuesday I left. And Wednesday morning of that week, in the next morning, one of my brothers came to stay with her. My mother was taken by ambulance, and she wanted my brother to call the ambulance and have her taken to the hospital. She has learned in her trips to the hospital that if she goes by car to the hospital, that you go and you sit in the waiting room for anywhere 6 to 8 hours or thereabouts, and you have to sit in a chair. If you go by ambulance, you may wait a while, but you stay on a gurney. Ambulance is the more expensive way to go, but I'm just telling you that's what has been happening lately. She has pain in her back. She's had pleurisy, which is very painful for her. She used to have trouble with compression fractures in her spine. She's had congestive heart failure. Of course, 3 years ago, she had a new heart valve installed, and that's helped her immensely. Since that time, she improved very much, but she's getting poor again. And she complains about pain frequently and has no appetite. She doesn't eat well. She's beginning to become confused about when she takes her medications, her Lasix, and all of those other things, and her blood pressure medicine. And those are all critical things. But anyhow, my world came to a real alert on Friday morning, May the 21st, when I woke up. I woke up to discover that I had a text message that was sent at 3:50 in the morning, and it was waiting for me. It was from my brother, John, who was there. John is a little younger than I am. He's been a professor with a number of state university systems, but most recently he's retired from Ohio State University, and he teaches laboratory medicine, and he's from living out in Lima, Ohio. So my brother John sent me this message, and I'll read it to you. Hi, Don. Mom called me into the hospital in the middle of the night, outside of visiting hours. She thinks this is the end. She asked that I let you know, and you can, quote, can do with it what you want, end quote. She is comfortable and peaceful. I prayed with her and sang to her. So I didn't hear the ding on my phone at 3:50 in the morning, But I saw that about 6 o'clock in the morning, and immediately my day started, as you might imagine. Now, what compounded this problem was my sister had said earlier that when she'd gone into the hospital, she overheard something about morphine. And I had jumped to the conclusion that she was on morphine for her pain. And morphine and pain, when morphine is used for pain, it's kind of a sign to me that the end is really near, that's what they use at times like that. I don't know that that's accurate, but anyhow, I thought it was at this time that I got this call. So that morning was a terrible, terrible awakening morning. I immediately texted back my brother and said, "Is Mom still able to talk?" Because I didn't know if she was still alive yet or not. And he said, "Yes, but her breath is very, very limited. She's very, very short of breath." So I said to him, "I'm going to try to call her." He said, "Okay." So I went through with that call, got her on the phone, and I began to talk to my mother. And what do you say when you believe your mother is dying? What would you say? All I can tell you is I cried my way through that phone call. I talked to her about our hope in the Lord, our trust in the Lord, and our belief that, you know, heaven is a wonderful place. And I prayed with her. And I closed the conversation out with her, fully believing that I would never see my mother alive again. And I said, "Mom, I'll see you on the other side." So I hung up the phone. I began to try to go about our day, but all of a sudden it was like my brain was in a fog. I thought, here I am. I've had my final conversation with my mother. I'm never going to see her again. I'm never going to hear her voice again. We got to think about funeral arrangements and all that stuff. We got to go through all that stuff, and then we're going to have to clean out her apartment. And we're going to have to just deal with all those things that we don't want to deal with. Just before noon that morning, I sent a text message to our prayer chain. These are the words of my text message. "I would appreciate prayer for my mom and my family. I believe they put my mom on comfort care this morning. My mom believes that it won't be long before she sees Jesus. Thanks for praying." And so people would understand it was me clearly and wouldn't ask the question, "Who is this?" I put my name there. For the first part of that day, my brain was really in a fog. I didn't know whether I was coming or going. You know, you can shave in a fog and not cut your nose off, and I was successful at that. You can drive in a fog, but you're really not as alert as you ought to be, and it's a little harder to pay attention. I was beginning to think of how to notify people, how to plan services, how to clean out the apartment, and I was beginning to think of life without my mother, and I was really stressed. This morning, I want to ask you the question, how does our Heavenly Father help us through times like that? How does our Heavenly Father go with us through times like that? I can honestly say that I did not begin to blame God for anything. I just felt numb. I couldn't say that I understood exactly what God was doing because I felt numb and just disconnected. Not that I wasn't loved by my Heavenly Father, but just simply, I couldn't hear what he was saying at that time. I didn't know what he was saying or what he was trying to say. And so this morning, as we look at a couple of things in Peter's life, one of the great things that is wonderful is the fact that Jesus never changes. Can you say hallelujah? He never changes. He never changes. My circumstances were changing, and I felt like I was on a long slide that I had no control over whatsoever as I was in that day. And how can that fact stabilize our spiritual walk? There, three of Peter's experiences are what I want to focus on today. And so we're going to look at his confession, we're going to look at his denial of Christ, and last of all, I want to read from 2 Peter, from where he gives a perspective on life. So this morning, Matthew chapter 16. When Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" So they said, "Some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." But he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" This question, "Who do you say that I am?" is a question for every human being that has ever been on this planet. It has to be answered. We can say we don't know who that is. We can say that he didn't exist. We can say that he's just a person that was an imposter. We can say all kinds of things about him. We can say anything that comes to our mind about him. But today, who do you say that Jesus is? Peter was the one that was getting asked the question. The question comes to each and every one of us as human beings. Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I say to you that you are Peter," and here's where Peter's name was changed from Simon, "and on this rock," Peter means small stone, "and on this rock," speaking the word there, rock means a large stone, "I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against us. It, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loose in heaven." Peter was very proud of his answer that day. I'm sure that, as I said earlier, Peter really glowed when he gave this kind of an answer. And if he could purr, he was purring at that time. But he gave the answer. He said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Those are more than simple words. Those are more than simply identifying someone. Because if he acknowledged that he was the Christ, the Son of the living God, that was blasphemy to the Jewish people. He was making a statement that Jesus was not just a good man. Jesus was not just a moral teacher. But Jesus was the long-promised Messiah, and he was making that statement at that time about him. So it's far more significant than that. And Peter was proud of that day because of the way that Jesus commended him for his comment. "Flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." And so, brothers and sisters, wherever you are in your walk with the Lord today, if you know that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, that isn't because you were taught that way. That is because it was revealed to you, and all of a sudden it came together in your mind and it became a revelation. I like to talk with people about how they come to Christ. I like to hear their stories because it's like a light comes on in life. It's like something happens. There are times when you can talk to people about Jesus all day long and nothing happens at all with them. But then all of a sudden, the light will come on and something will happen in their hearts and lives. And it's a life-changing experience that happens there. By the way, this evening is another one of our Jesus Factor meetings that I'll be having in Albion. And it's a small service, and it's geared toward working with and helping those who are struggling with addictions. The service is called Jesus Factor because Jesus is the factor that is so helpful in overcoming temptations that are a component of addictions. Now let's go and look at something else today. Let's look at Peter's worst day of his life, and as we move toward that, here we go to Matthew chapter 26. Now Peter sat outside in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him saying, "You also were with Jesus of Galilee." But he denied it before them all, saying, "I do not know what you're saying." And when he had gone out to the gateway, another girl saw him and said to those who were there, "This fellow also was with Jesus of Nazareth." But again he denied with an oath, "I do not know the man." Do you hear what Peter's saying? Peter, the one who said, "This is the Christ, the Son of the living God," what happened to him? But what was happening in his relationship with Jesus? That's the more important question I want to ask you today. And as we read some more of that same passage of Scripture, "And a little while later, those who stood by came up and said to Peter, 'Surely you are one of them, because your speech betrays you.'" He had that dialect. He had that accent. There was something about the way he put his words together that made it that he was from Galilee, and he was probably with the Jesus people. "Then he began to curse and swear, saying, 'I do not know the man.' And immediately a rooster crowed." A rooster crowed. How many times have roosters crowed? They seem to crow lots of times, many times in a day sometimes. They're just proud of the ability to raise their voice as they do. And Peter remembered the word of Jesus, who had said to him, "Before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly. Peter was at the very bottom of his life at this point in time. And where was Jesus? Where was the help that Peter needed? When you get to the very bottom of your difficulty and your challenge in life, where is Jesus? I want to tell you this morning, he was where he always was. He's the unchanging one. He's the one that doesn't move, although life may move us around quite a bit. And let's look at Peter's perspective as he gets into the later years of his life. As he went to the later years of his life, this is from 1 Peter chapter 1. And here's Peter. Now Peter's hair is a different color, I'm sure. His beard is a different color. It's no longer the reddish or the brown, whatever it was. You know, he must have had a red beard because of his temper and his temperament. He had to have that to match that. I don't know. But anyhow, he's saying, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Peter now could talk about a living hope, not about highs and lows, but he could talk about a living hope now. And in verse 4, he said, "To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you." And he's talking to people who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Peter is talking about his great confidence in the Lord and his great trust in the Lord now. The trials are past. The mountaintop experience is in his background. The bottom of the valley, the deepest valley, is in his background. But he says, "We have a hope that continues and endures." And now going on to verse number 6. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, in whom, having not seen, you love. Though now you do not see him, yet believing, you rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Peter is talking about the big picture now, where Jesus, who does not change, has been there. How can we stabilize our spiritual journey? You know, I think it's really so important and so helpful. I look back at that terrible time I had a couple of weeks ago about believing my mother was going to pass, and thankfully she's still living. She's in rehabilitation right now, and she hasn't been doing really good, so when you think of me and think of her, pray for us as we work our way through this journey. My mother is probably not being the best patient all the time either, complaining about her food, but she didn't complain about food when I was growing up. She applied a little correction to the seat of my backside when I complained about food. But she used to eat everything that she fixed, because, you know, she could choose what she wanted to fix. But my mom, of course, I love her, and it's just funny in some ways, and it strikes her funny at times that once she took care of me, and now I'm taking care of her off and on. We take turns in this life. How does Jesus help us smooth that highway through life that we go through, that journey? How can we get the shock absorbers to take out the pain of the bumps that are going there? I think there are some things that we need to do. I believe that we should enjoy worship and worship God with abandon. If you love Jesus, love him with all of your heart. He has done so much for you. Worship songs cannot do him fully justice as to what he has done, but he is better than the best worship song. He is greater than the greatest satisfaction you've ever had. The scripture says that in his presence is fullness of joy. And we may be happy when we're singing and we're worshiping God because of his goodness and his love, but heaven is sweeter and better than that as well. It's just a grand and a glorious place. But I think that's an important thing for us to do, that we forsake not the assembling of ourselves together. We come together to worship God, and it's something that we can do in a group. You can worship God at home, and you can worship God in private as well. But it's so more powerful when we do it together as a group. We can stabilize our journey by knowing the fact that tests will come in this journey. There are tests and trials that will come. It is a battle at times. It is rough at times. Brothers and sisters, when you're prepared for the battle and ready for the battle, then you're mentally not caught off guard. And we shouldn't allow ourselves to be caught off guard. We should be aware that being prepared is important. God's plan for your life is completed as you seek him in all of your life. That's God's plan in your life. How to stabilize, prepare, maintain, and practice or participate in those things. And the other day as I was visiting my mother, and it's been painful visiting my mother, but I want to tell you about this. I went to the rehab center, and we're in a big cold room, and she's huddled under a heavy sweatshirt and a blanket, and she's shivering, and she's shaking, and she's cold, and I know she's feeling miserable. She has pain. She has no appetite to eat properly. We're concerned about all of that stuff. And because of her conditions, mentally she's having real trouble remembering some of the things that happen, some of the things that go on, whether she ate, whether she didn't eat, and what she did eat. And she thinks that she always has a terrible night and can't sleep. But anyhow, the first day that I visited her in rehab, I didn't have a Bible with me, so I pulled out my cell phone, which I have a Bible app on, and I was going to read from that with her. And I said, "Mom, I want to read some scripture with you. Is there anything you would like me to read for you?" And she started, "Blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper." I was waiting for my mother to tell me what she'd like to have me read to her, and she began to quote from the first psalm. She completed the entire first psalm. Now, I remember when my parents didn't go to church when I was a little kid. I remember when my father came to know the Lord with a dramatic change in his life. I remember what happened. And I remember my father leading us as a family to go to the house of the Lord together and worship in the same church together. I remember those things happening. Part of me wants to ask, "Mom, when did you memorize the first psalm?" But I do know from talking with her that when she was a child, her family took her to church. Her family would go to church. They went to a Presbyterian church in Nebraska, and a Presbyterian church, I believe, in Colorado, in Fort Collins, Colorado, was where she graduated from high school. She'd been involved in those things. And over the years that I've known my mother, I know that she has known scripture, but it was such a blessing to me personally to have her start to quote that first psalm. My brothers and sisters today, how can we stabilize our lives? It's trusting him and holding on. Here's what I found. I found, as I'm looking back on that low point in my life, I didn't come away angry at God. I didn't come away questioning if God existed. I came away just so thankful for what he has done for me. And he will do the same for you, because he loves you. Stand with me this morning as we begin to conclude our service today. Praise the Lord. Father, as we come to you this day, I ask, Lord, that you will help us to see that you are ever faithful. And even though there are times in which we are up and times in which we are painfully down, you are there just the same. You are there all the time, and you are there waiting patiently for us to find you. And Lord, this morning, thank you for your patience. Thank you for your great love for us, O Lord. Thank you for being there at that time. Father, I pray today that every person under the sound of my voice has come to know you as the Son of the Living God, as the Christ, as the Savior of their Savior. And I pray, O Lord, that you will just help everyone who is here to know you in a deep and in a powerful way. And Father, this morning, and may I ask, while heads are bowed and eyes are closed, if you're here and you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, you haven't accepted him, or you're not sure that he is the Son of God, I would like to pray with you this morning. I would like to say a special prayer, and I would ask that you just please raise your hand if you want me to pray for that, if you are seeking that for yourself, because the Lord is seeking you. Anyone, anywhere. And so, Father, this morning as we look to you, you are the stabilizer of our life. You are the one who does not change. You are the Lord of Lords, and you are the King of Kings. And Father, today, as we go through the difficult times in life, be there as you have promised to be. And Lord, may our hearts beat with confirmation of your presence in our lives. And now, Father, help us to be representatives of you as we go out into this world, into our homes, into our families, into our communities, Lord. May you be seen in our lives, and may you be glorified through us. We ask, O Lord, all of these things today in Jesus' mighty name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. God bless you. You are dismissed, and our retiring offering is there for you. Praise God.